Good evening, everyone. Dry eye disease is one of the most commonly asked questions in the examination and also one of the most commonly encountered diseases in the clinical setting. So it makes sense to describe this condition in a little more detail. So beginning, the very first thing we need to understand is about the lacrimal gland itself. Now the lacrimal gland is what produces most of the tear film that is present in the eye, and the afferent nerve supply for the lacrimal gland comes from the fifth cranial nerve, that is the trigeminal, and more specifically the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve, whereas the efferent supply is via the seventh cranial nerve, more specifically the superior branch of the zygomatic nerve. So dry eye is basically due to either an inadequate tear volume, either due to inadequate production of tears, inadequate function of the tears, inadequate function of the tears, or thirdly, it is either in an elderly or a postmenopausal individual, in which case it is called a senile dry eye due to an old age. Let's quickly look at the tear film in more detail. So the tear film, the thickness is about 7 to 8 microns on an average. It is thickest immediately after blinking, in which case it will measure about 8 microns. And after 30 seconds of keeping the eyes continuously open, it keeps thinning out, it keeps reducing in thickness until it reaches a thickness of about 4 microns. Okay. The volume of tear film is about 7 microliters and it is produced at the rate of about 1.2 microliter per minute. Means every 6th or 7th minute it gets completely replenished, so it has a very high turnover rate. The pH is about 7.3 to 7.7. There is a range, but if you are asked for a single best answer in an MCQ, the answer is 7.4. Alright? And the tear film itself is made up of 3 layers. The first is the lipid layer, the second is the aqueous layer, and the third is the mucin layer or the mucus layer. Mucin or mucus, it both refer to the same. So let's deal with these one by one. First, let's look at the lipid layer. The lipid layer is the outermost, which means it is in contact with the environment. It measures about 0.1 to 0.2 microns thick. It is produced mainly by the meibomian glands, which are present in the eyelids. However, there are also accessory glands which produce this. These are the glands of Zeiss and glands of Mohl. So these are the accessory lipid producing or sebaceous glands. The functions of the lipid layer is basically to prevent evaporation of the underlying layers. And that is because it is a fat, it is a fatty substance, it is a lipid, so it prevents the evaporation of the liquidy substances below it. It acts as a barrier to skin lipids. It provides a smooth surface for the eyelids to glide, so there is no foreign body sensation because of the lipid layer. And it provides a clear refractive surface, so that light which strikes on the cornea does not undergo refraction at this level. It provides a clear surface, and it also acts as a surfactant because of its fatty nature. The next layer is the aqueous. Which lies beneath the lipid layer. It measures 7 microns, so this constitutes the maximum thickness of the tear film, so most of it is aqueous. It is produced by the lacrimal gland, which is present in the superior temporal part of each orbit. This is the main lacrimal gland that is present in the superior temporal part. There are also accessory lacrimal glands, and those are called glands of Krauss and glands of Wolfram. Many a times in MCQs are, so Krauss and Wolfram are accessory aqueous producing accessory lacrimal glands. Apart from this, the functions are to provide oxygen to the cornea, because the corneal epithelium does not have blood vessels. The cornea itself is avascular, so to receive its nutrients in the oxygen, it has to take up the diffusion from the tear film. So this aqueous layer provides this oxygen. It washes away the debris, since it is the thickest layer of the tear film, and also takes care of the irritants that might enter the tear film. And the last function is, it contains lysozyme and beta lysin, both of which have antibacterial nature. And let's take care of the mucus layer. So mucus is closest to the cornea and the conjunctiva. So it is stuck to the cornea and the conjunctiva. It measures about 0.02 to 0.04 microns. So as you can see, it is the thinnest layer of the tear film. It is produced by the goblet cells of the conjunctiva. And there are also accessory cells that produce. Those are known as the crypts of Henle and the glands of Mans. I'm sorry, these are just names that you need to memorize. There is nothing more that I can do in this situation. So the function of the mucus layer is basically to lubricate the ocular and the palpebral surfaces. It produces a slippery coating on the foreign bodies because of its mucus nature. So the foreign bodies do not incite a reaction on the cornea and the conjunctiva. So to understand dry eye disease, the first thing that you need to understand is that dry eye is not a disease as such, but a symptom of an underlying disease. So if we have to discuss the etiology, what causes a dry eye, we have to understand what all cause this symptom of dry eye, and understand that it is not a disease as such, but it is actually a symptom of some other disease that is already present in the eye. So based on the mechanism of action, the first etiological classification is dry eye due to an aqueous insufficiency. In simple words, enough tear film is not getting produced. This condition is also known as keratoconjunctivitis sicca. So what causes an aqueous deficiency? The first and foremost, the most important one, is called Sjögren's syndrome. In this case, it is also known as primary keratoconjunctivitis, because there is no cause as such to this illness, to this disease. And the second is non-Sjögren's syndrome, which means all other causes which are not due to Sjögren's. So under non-Sjögren's, there are a couple of causes that you need to know. The first is senile, which is basically due to an old age. That is the first under non-Sjögren's. The next is a lacrimal gland defect, which can either be congenital, in which case the lacrimal gland itself is absent, in case of sarcoidosis, in tumors involving the lacrimal gland, or tumors of the orbit which are compressing the lacrimal gland, in cases of post radiation, patients who have received radiation around the eyeball, and post surgical. Say for example, the patient had a tumor, you removed the tumor, but you had to remove the lacrimal gland also along with that. The next is in case of a duct obstruction. a lacrimal duct obstruction, which can happen in case of trachoma, in chemical burns, a condition called cicatricial pemphigoid, and lastly Stevens-Johnson's syndrome. So all of these can produce a duct obstruction primarily due to a fibrosis of the lacrimal duct. And lastly, if there is reflex hyposecretion, which can happen in a condition which has a very specific name, Riley-Day syndrome. In Parkinsonism, now we know that the afferent pathway of the lacrimal gland is the 7th cranial nerve. So if the 7th cranial nerve is damaged, you are going to have reflex hyposecretion. In cases of contact lens users and this is due to a prolonged contact lens wear causing a a decreased sensation of the cornea. Alright, so that takes care of the causes of the aqueous deficiency. Now let's look at the second one, which is due to an insufficient function of the tear film that is already present. I'm sorry. Okay, so we've seen that this is due to an aqueous deficiency. The second is due to an evaporative mechanism, which means there is an unstable tear film. So what is this instability due to? The first and most important cause is a meibomian gland dysfunction. The lipid layer is what maintains the remaining two layers. It prevents the evaporation of those layers. So if the lipid layer is defective, which means the meibomian gland which produces the lipid layer is defective, you are going to have an unstable tear film. And the most important cause under meibomian gland dysfunction is chronic posterior blepharitis. Suppose there is a congenital absence of the meibomian glands, you are going to have a similar clinical picture. And finally, a condition called rosacea. The next is lagophthalmos. Lagophthalmos basically means incomplete closure of the two eyelids. So some amount of cornea and conjunctiva remain exposed to the environment, which happens very commonly in a 7th nerve palsy. Because the orbicularis oculi, the muscle closing the eye, the two eyelids and bringing the eyelids together, is supplied by the 7th cranial nerve. Suppose the patient has proptosis for whatever cause, thyroid ophthalmopathy, there is a retroorbital tumor. Because of that, the eyeball is protruding outside, you are going to have lagophthalmos and you may have it in symblepharon, which are adhesions between the upper and the lower lids. Suppose the patient has defective blinking. Blinking restores the tear film thickness. At the beginning it is 7 microns, and at the end of 30 seconds it is 4 microns. So if the patient doesn't blink enough number of times, you are going to have an excessively thin tear film, and thin tear film is again unstable. This very often happens in a computer user. You know, people working in the IT sector who have a habit of staring at things for longer duration, especially digital screens, those people are going to be prone to having a dry eye. Or suppose the person is intellectually disabled. Dry eye can also happen in a condition very common in children, vitamin A deficiency, in which case I will call the eye to have xerophthalmia. So understand, when I use the word xerophthalmia, I am only dealing with the dry eye that is caused due to a vitamin A deficiency. Whereas if I say xerosis, it may or may not involve vitamin A, there might be other causes, but it means that there is keratinization in the eye. The cornea and the conjunctiva undergo keratinization. If they undergo keratinization, only then can I call it xerosis. Alright? Certain topical medications are also known to cause a tear film instability, and the most common is beta blocker. This alters the lipid layer of the tear film, and it is very commonly used in glaucoma. In fact, it is the first line therapy unless contraindicated in glaucoma. And other category of drugs is antihistaminics, such as olopatadine. These are very commonly prescribed for allergic conjunctivitis or allergic eye disease. And finally, contact lens users again can have a unstable tear film, which is again due to reduced corneal sensations because of a chronic use of contact lenses. Let's look at a couple of clinical features in case of a dry eye disease. How will the patient present to you? So let's look at the symptoms. The first is he is going to come to you with foreign body sensation, which is the most common symptom, and very often it is complained as sand in the eyes. A sensation as if sand has gone in the eyes. The second is ocular irritation, itching, a very vague complaint of non-specific discomfort, and lastly, sore eyes, which are chronic in nature, lasting for months or years on end. This patient is going to complain. One very peculiar feature is all these symptoms will worsen as the day progresses. So he is going to have the worst symptoms just before going to bed, and he is going to have the least symptoms when he wakes up in the morning. So that is the progression. The symptoms worsen throughout the day. Suppose the patient comes to you with features of dry eye, dry mouth, and a palpable swelling in the parotid region. Start suspecting Sjögren's syndrome. This is a classical triad of Sjögren's syndrome: dry eye with dry mouth and palpable swellings in one or both parotid glands, usually bilateral. And this is because in Sjögren's syndrome, there is an exocrine gland attack, most likely due to an autoimmune mechanism. So all the exocrine glands of the body producing secretions, you are going to have a damage to those and lymphocytic infiltration of those specific organs. So for example, if it is affecting the lacrimal gland and the salivary glands, you are going to have lymphocytic infiltrate over there. What signs will you see in this patient? So when I'm examining such a patient of dry eye disease, so I'm talking about dry eye now completely, Sjögren's is done. The very first is I will examine the tear film of this patient. And the first is the tear film thickness that I see, which is also known as the marginal strip, the marginal tear strip. It is going to be less than 1 millimeter. In a normal individual, it is about 1 to 2 millimeters. But in the case of dry eye, it is going to be lesser than 1 millimeter. There is going to be froth that is present at the tear strip margin, at the lid margin. And this is classical of meibomian dysfunction. So meibomian gland dysfunction, look for froth at the tear strip margin. And the mucus layer is going to aggregate and form strings. So you are going to have a stringy mucus appearance. If I examine the conjunctiva of such a patient, I will see mild congestion because of a chronic inflammatory reaction. Because now this conjunctiva is directly exposed to the environment. The tear film is thinner. The antibiotic properties of the tear film also reduce because of the reduced thickness. So there is a chronic inflammatory reaction in the conjunctiva. The conjunctiva loses its shine, so it is also called lusterless conjunctiva. And there may or may not be xerosis depending on how severe is the disease. If keratinization has happened, I will call it a case of conjunctival xerosis. And finally, if I see keratinization, it is always called conjunctival xerosis. Finally, because of a chronic inflammation in the conjunctiva, there is going to be a thickened conjunctiva that is present, and this thickened conjunctiva is called a conjunctivocalasis, which means it is a wasteful tissue. It is just a tissue because of an inflammation, And even after the inflammatory reaction reduces, this aberrant tissue, this extra tissue persists. So very often it requires surgical excision if it does not respond to topical medications. Finally, if I come to the corneal examination, so cornea also loses its shine. So it is called lusterless because a fluid layer above it will give it the shine that you see. If there is no fluid, there is no shine. So a lusterless cornea, very often you get punctate epithelial erosions. You get filaments of mucus, which is again a continuation of the stringy mucus that you see on the conjunctiva. So if you see it on the cornea, you will see it in a filament fashion, and very often this filament is attached at one end on the cornea and floating at the other. So these filaments appear very floating with just an anchor at one end. If these filaments aggregate, these become larger to appear like a plaque fashion. So you get a mucus plaque because of an aggregation of these mucus filaments. And suppose there, this has been caused due to a trachoma, this has been caused due to a chemical burns, then there is an evidence of the underlying cause. Say for example, you will get signs of a chemical burn, you will get signs of trachoma. The fisto grading system that you see, if you see those features along with the dry eye, start considering that this dry eye is because of that primary cause. What investigations would you like to do in a patient of dry eye? You can't directly start treatment. So there are certain investigations that you need to do. The first and foremost, the most important, is something called tear film break up time, which is defined as a time interval between one complete blink and appearance of first dry spot. On the cornea. So how do you actually do the test? Definition is okay for theoretical purposes. How do you actually do the test? You stain the cornea with a fluorescein dye. Usual concentration is 2% fluorescein dye, just for the sake of MCQs. Many a times they ask you. And the structures in the eye, on the surface of the eye, that take up the fluorescein dye are the tear film, because the fluorescein itself gets redistributed on the tear film, and an abnormal cornea, which means a cornea that has an epithelial defect. Normal cornea will not take up the fluorescein dye. So suppose the tear film dries up and the dye comes in direct contact with the normal cornea, it will not stain. So the part of the fluorescein dye that is in the tear film will appear fluorescent, which is done under a cobalt blue filter light. It is not under regular light. But the underlying normal cornea will not take up the dye and it will appear black in color. So the first dry spot is seen as a first black spot under the cobalt blue filter. And it usually indicates mucus layer deficiency. The normal tear film breakup time is about 15 to 35 seconds. As you see, there is a very long, large range. But if the value is less than 10 seconds, start suspecting an unstable tear film. The second investigation that we do is something called Schirmer's test. And Schirmer's is always done after tear film breakup time. This is because in Schirmer's test, you place a Schirmer strip on the conjunctiva, which may or may not come in contact with the cornea. And if the cornea gets damaged because of the strip, and then you do a tear film breakup time, you will get a false negative. Because now the corneal erosion will take up the stain, and the dry spot will appear fluorescent instead of black. So that is why you always do it after tear film breakup time. And the Schirmer strip is also called Wattman filter paper number 41. This is just a name that you need to remember. This was the scientist who discovered, and named the filter paper in his own honor instead of keeping it very simple. The Schirmer strip is it is also called a Schirmer strip. The filter paper is also called the Schirmer strip, and it is folded at the 0 millimeter mark. It is kept in the lower fornix at the junction of lateral 1/3 and the medial 2/3. And the patient is asked to look up without blinking for a duration of 5 minutes. It's a very difficult thing to do. So this without blinking is a little, a gray zone. The patient is asked not to oppose both his upper and lower eyelids together. He can do slight movements which wet the cornea and the conjunctiva, but ask him not to completely close his eyelids. And this it is left for 5 minutes. The normal value of Schirmer strip. Now, if you are placing a paper in the conjunctiva, the paper is going to get wet, and depending on how much wetness of the conjunctiva of the paper at the end of 5 minutes, you will determine whether this is normal or a dry eye disease. So normally at the end of 5 minutes, this filter paper is wet for more than 15 millimeters. So there are gradings on the paper itself, and if the wetness exceeds 15 millimeters, it means it is a normal eye. The tear film production and stability is normal. However, if you get a reading between 10 to 15 millimeters, it is called a mild dry eye disease. If you get it between 5 to 10, it is called moderate. And if it is less than 5 millimeters, it is called a severe dry eye disease. Also, you do not use anesthesia while doing this test. However, I can use it for various purposes. So if I do not use an anesthesia, which is a very difficult thing to do, it is called Schirmer's test 1. But if I use a topical anesthesia, it is called Schirmer's test. This is 1, and with a topical anesthesia, it is Schirmer's test 2. The third test that I can do, again a dye-based test, is something called rose bengal staining. So rose bengal is again a dye which has a concentration of 1%. This can either be in the form of a drop or again a strip, a fluorescent strip. And there are 3 patterns of staining of rose bengal that are reported. There is a pattern A, a pattern B, and a pattern C. The A pattern is when the rose bengal stains the conjunctiva and the cornea. Pattern B is when there is extensive staining involving large parts of the cornea and the conjunctiva. And pattern C is fine punctate staining in the interpalpebral area only. So that is how you classify the different patterns of rose bengal staining. Depending on how bad is the dry eye, there are grading systems that are used. So there is a grade or a level, level 1, level 2, level 3, and level 4. Level 1 is for mild dry eye disease, 2 is for moderate, 3 is for severe, and 4 is for very severe dry eye disease. So depending on what grade it is, your treatment will vary. Grade 1 will require very mild treatment, a very low level treatment, whereas grade 4 will require aggressive therapy with possibly immunomodulation. So how do you treat a case of dry eye disease? Since it is not a disease as such, it is an underlying symptom of some other pathology, there is no cure to the dry eye itself. The treatment is largely symptomatic, and the first modality of therapy is giving tear substitutes. If the tears are not sufficient, give tears from the outside. These might be in the form of drops, ointments, or ocular inserts. Ointments are preferred over drops simply because they are oil based and they remain in the conjunctival sac for longer duration as compared to drops, which might get washed out by the blinking. The most commonly used drug is called carboxymethyl cellulose. Otherwise, you can use polyvinyl alcohol. Along with tear substitutes, there is a different category of drugs which can be utilized to increase the secretion of the tears itself, and these are called secretagogues. Instead of substituting tears, these stimulate the production of tears, and these drugs are pilocarpine, sevelamine, and rebamipide. Now the problem with these drugs is they are not very efficacious, which means they do not show the same amount of effect in all patients. So consequently, the side effect profile are also different, because of which these are not very much preferred, but just for the sake of names and MCQs, please note down those names. The second is, if the dry eye is not responding to tear films alone, topical immunomodulators can be utilized. These can be either in the form of mild steroids, something like fluoromethylone, or if it is not responding to steroids, topical cyclosporin. It acts by diminishing the cell mediated immunity, and the concentration is usually 0.05 or 0.1%. The third category of drugs that can be utilized, suppose the patient has a lot of mucus strings, mucolytics, and the most common drug used is 5% acetylcysteine. So acetylcysteine is also used systemically to as a mucolytic for cough, and this disperses or breaks down the mucus threads that are present, the filaments that you see. The fourth strategy is to decrease the evaporation of the tears, and this can be done by decreasing the room temperature, using moist chambers to maintain the humidity, or using protective glasses. To prevent evaporation. The next strategy is to reduce the drainage of tears that are being formed. So we know that tears are formed by the lacrimal gland but drained by the lacrimal sac. So if there is a way to occlude the lacrimal sac opening, which means if you can perform a punctal occlusion, it can reduce the tear film drainage. This can either be temporary, in which case the punctum is occluded by a collagen implant, or it can be a permanent occlusion, in which case it is a silicone implant. The other surgical option that you have is performing tarsorrhaphy, in which I bring the two lids closer to each other so that there is less evaporation from the exposed parts, because the exposed part itself is reduced. The two lids are brought close to each other and stitched at the medial or the lateral, at the lateral canthus, I'm sorry. Suppose there is an underlying cause. For example, if the dry eye is due to a vitamin A deficiency or due to a chronic blepharitis, you treat that particular cause depending on the cause itself. Fatty acid supplements, that omega fatty acid supplements, are also said to help the production of tear film. And lastly, a newer concept of autologous serum, which means I take blood from the individual, I separate the serum from the cellular components, and I take the serum and make eye drops out of it by using certain preservatives. So that has also been said to have a relatively better efficacy than the surgical causes. However, studies are still going on. Let's take a look at a couple of photographs of dry eye. So this is the basic pathway of the tear film. Here is the gland and here is the sac. The tear will flow right across the eyeball and get drained. This is how you would appear in a Sjögren syndrome. There is a dry, furry or coated tongue, also called a fissured tongue, with an enlargement over the parotid region, which could be unilateral or bilateral, with a lot of lymphocytic infiltrate if you do a parotid gland biopsy in this patient. The purple parts that you see are all the lymphocytes, there is so much lymphocytic infiltrate, it starts destroying the tissue and there is a severe inflammatory reaction. This is how a meibomian gland dysfunction appears. Like, there are dot-like appearances at the margin of the meibomian glands. This is where they are present in the lids, just next to the tarsal plane. And these enlarged are due to a collection of inflammatory material within them, and the meibomian gland is not able to secrete the lipid layer properly. Another image of posterior blepharitis, if you can see, this is the inflammatory aggregate, and there are a lot of aggregates that you can see over here with lid notching that is present in the case of posterior blepharitis. This is how a conjunctival staining appears. The first one is a fluorescein dye, this greenish dye that you can see. The next one is the rose Bengal, which is a rosy color or a pinkish color that you can appear. And look at the third image. The tear film doesn't appear clear. It appears very granular with some dusty appearance in it. And this is because the mucus layer has undergone degeneration and produces something called mucus debris. And you can see certain filaments over here that are starting to become. And look at the tear film margin in this individual. It is high, very, very thin, less than 1 millimeter. Compared to this image, which is the other extreme. So this is an enlarged and a thickened tear film margin, a marginal tear strip. Certain corneal signs that are important, there are punctate epithelial erosions that you can see, the dot-like appearances, which are stain positive. So these highly refractile particles, like particle-like appearance that you see, these are the epithelial erosions. Now, because the epithelium has gotten eroded, it is stain positive. And here you can see the filamental formation. The filament is attached at this end and it is freely floating. So with each blink of the individual, the filaments will appear to move and sway as if in the wind. This is how the filaments will appear in a rose Bengal stain. And finally, if the filaments aggregate and become larger, this is how the plaque-like appearance is seen. This is how you do the tear film breakup time. The normal tear film takes up all the fluorescein dye. But if you let it dry for a little bit, the normal cornea does not take up, and this is how the blackish appearance of the cornea is seen. This is because the normal cornea does not take up the fluorescein dye. And the first black spot that you see in the cornea, that is when you measure the time. And that is how we do tear film breakup time. This is the Schirmer strip with a zero mark here, with readings at every 5 millimeters and lines at every 1 millimeter. And since this is more than 15 millimeter staining, assuming that it is after 5 minutes, this patient has a normal eye. And there is no dry eye in such an individual. So that takes care of the dry eye disease. I hope this lecture is useful. Suggestions, as always, are very, very welcome. I understand that a lot of online lectures are being conducted nowadays, and it might be difficult to take care of all of them. But I assure you that I am going to be doing my best. And let me know if there's any suggestions that can be made. So thank you. Happy learning and be safe. Good night.